So we will have now a panel on European universities in 2015 and beyond. And then I will ask the three participants, Professor Kurt de Cantelaer, Professor Ana Costa Freitas, and Professor Antonio Magalhães Cunha. Please sit down here. First of all, we'll have the first presentation by Professor Kurt de Cantelaer, the Secretary General of the League of European Research Universities, LERU. Please take the floor.
Thank you, Mr. President. I still have 20 minutes, or? Mr. President, I still have 20 minutes? Just to be sure, because I have the, anyway, already the habit to speak too long, so I just want to be sure that I can go on for 20 minutes.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you very much. All right, ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon, and first of all, I would like to thank Alea for the invitation to come and speak here. It's a really great pleasure to meet several of you again. In the past, I've been working quite a lot with Yuri Engelbrecht, but I'm very glad to be here with you today under the presidency of Professor Günter Stock. And it's clear that this is also a very dynamic organization, and I hope that we will meet soon again with Alea in the ERA platform, if later this year in Brussels the ERA platform would be enlarged to other organizations. I certainly would like to see Alea coming on board as one of those organizations, and certainly you can count on us to support any discussion on that. I will talk about, of course, as was requested, the Lisbon agenda, which I think is a fantastic topic to address today, also in view of what happened last week when the European Research Area and Innovation Committee adopted the ERA roadmap 2015-2020, which is another additional document adding to the huge pile of documents dealing with the Lisbon strategy. And of course, I'm not going to dwell on all those topics, but it clearly indicates that this topic is still very much alive, and that obviously a lot of us still hope that we can do something with this European research area as it was launched many years ago by the Lisbon agenda. I hope I don't have to dwell too long on what the League of European Research Universities is. I hope that most of you are familiar with LERU. We are a group of 21 research-intensive universities spread over 10 countries in Europe, of which 9 in the EU. And we have as goals the promotion of the interests of fundamental research at EU level. But now there's also much more at national level. Secondly, we try to develop among the membership all kinds of best practices on all kinds of issues of research, innovation, and education policy. And thirdly, we also try to bring that to the international level, since LERU is building, together with similar organizations like LERU, a kind of international network of networks of research-intensive universities, for example, together with the Association of American Universities in the States, the C9 in China, and many more of those organizations worldwide. Let me come to the topic of today, the Lisbon agenda, the European research area. I thought it was very nice that in the flyer for the meeting today, it was indicated that the crown jewel of this vision, the vision of the Lisbon agenda, and I quote, would be a European research area, the envisaged backbone of the set knowledge-based economy. I thought that that was a very nice expression of what we are aiming at, the crown jewel. And the question is, of course, today, can we already speak about a crown jewel or not? ERA is for LERU, perhaps next to Horizon 2020, if it comes down to lobbying. But probably ERA is the most important topic for us. We have written on many issues of the European research area, several papers. We have taken very clear positions on ERA over the past few years. And the bottom line, I will come to that in the rest of my 20 minutes, the bottom line of all those positions are that we need more Europe. Already one of the colleagues this morning mentioned that we need more Europe. And although that in these not always obvious political times, certainly not in specific countries, I'm not going to mention any of them, but we all know which countries where EU membership can be an issue nowadays, it's clear that we need more Europe in the research policy, in the education and innovation policy, as it is developed by the European Union nowadays. So we need more ERA. We need really a realization of the European research area, because certainly we as universities, but I think also for universities in general, I think also for research funders, also for the academies, this is really a crucial framework. If we look ahead, today we are looking back to the year 2000 when ERA was launched, but I would like to look primarily ahead and to see where are we going to be in 10 years' time, in 20 years' time, in 30 years' time. And all of us, I bet that all of us, we all travel a lot to other parts of the world outside Europe. And we know that in certain parts of the world, this field of policy, research, innovation, education, is really going at high speed. And that it is really a challenge for the European Union to keep pace with those other parts of the world where more money, more effort, more attention, more commitment is going to research, innovation, and education. Because at the end of the day, and that also is something that is relevant for all of us, we all aim for excellence. And certainly the universities in my group are led by the notion of excellence in everything that they do. Obviously, we want to have excellent students, we want to have excellent staff, we want to have excellent infrastructure, we want to have an excellent environment in which all of us can work and study, and finally, of course, we all want to have excellent funding for everything that we do. And the fact that we all aim for excellence doesn't mean that all of us should be excellent research-intensive universities. No. The motto of LERU is clearly excellence in diversity, in a sense that institutions can, of course, be excellent in research, but they can also be excellent in education, in internationalization, in knowledge transfer, in regional integration. Because, of course, as we all know, at the end of the day, of course, we cannot support, let's say, 400 research-intensive universities of top level in Europe alone. So excellence is absolutely crucial for all of us. And excellence and the realizations of the conditions under which excellence can be developed, well, we can choose. Or we say, we are going to do that alone. Every institution, in every region, in every country of the EU can say, we are going to develop excellence and the conditions for growing excellence alone. And then we will compete alone with the rest of the world. But it's clear that this is one option. There is another option in which we say, we will try to develop this excellence and the conditions under which excellence can grow and flourish, we will develop that together. We will do that as a group of 28 member states. We will do that in a coordinated way. And as a group, at the end of the day, we will compete with the rest of the world. And in fact, the second scenario is in fact the basic idea which is embedded in the basic documents dealing with the European research area. And we always refer to the 2012 communication of the European Commission on the European research area. But very often we forget that in fact already in the year 2000, immediately after the launch of this notion of the Lisbon Strategy, a document was published by the European Commission on the European research area, a European communication of the 18th of January 2000. And in preparation of this meeting here today, I went back to that document. And in fact, if you read that document now, today, 2015, in fact, that was, and that still is, a fantastic visionary document. Because everything that we have been putting forward now, since the document of the Commission of 2012 was published, in fact, was already embedded in this document of the year 2000. And so this whole idea of the creation of an internal market in research with the establishment of a new fifth freedom, the free circulation of knowledge, and obviously I myself, as a lawyer specialized in European law, I very much like this terminology, an internal market for knowledge, for research, for innovation, the creation of a fifth freedom, that is what we have to aim at. And already in this document of 2000, this clearly has been indicated. And so in 2000, we had the idea, or at least the policymakers at that time, had the idea if we got things right, if we took the right approach, that we would come to a situation in Europe where, in fact, four crucial elements for universities would be supported, would be maintained, and would be reinforced, making it possible that we would be able to compete with the rest of the world. And those four crucial elements are, as I already indicated, first of all, excellence. Secondly, autonomy. You know that for us, universities, we are a strong defender of autonomy of our institutions, because research has clearly indicated that the performance of institutions increases with the autonomy of the institutions. We also need the necessary diversity, diversity in everything that we do, in the activities, in the staff, in students, things like that. Things which are now under threat in specific member states of the EU. And finally, a fourth crucial element for us universities in this whole setup of the research area is, of course, the establishment of partnerships. We cannot function alone anymore. A university which is thinking nowadays that he or she can develop activities alone and be a significant player on the global scene, well, he or she is clearly mistaken. So these elements are crucial. And we think, we are convinced that a well-established and a well-performing European research area can really contribute and reinforce those elements, because we must be aware of a number of dangers which are out there. Dangers which we know very well, not only as universities, but also as research funders. Reduced funding is the first one. Reduced funding is something that we have experienced over the past few years. Increased bureaucracy. And I'm very glad that Professor Carvalho is with us today, because if we have to thank one person for a reduced bureaucracy at EU level, it is Professor Carvalho. Simplification is now really meaning something at EU level. And I'm very glad that she announced this morning that we even can go further, and we are very much in support of that next phase in a further reduction of bureaucracy. And finally, another danger which is out there is isolation. The inwardness looking of countries, of institutions, of course, this all has to be avoided. So those threats must be countered. And they can be countered if we make sure that we realize this European research area. I have been primarily talking about the past now. Let me, for the last 10 minutes that I have, speak about the future. Have we realized this European research area in 2010, as it was the hope? Well, most speakers already indicated earlier today that this has not been the case. Of course, we have made progress. And certainly in the research field, as Professor Carvalho also has indicated this morning, In the research field, we certainly have made progress. Research and innovation is now in the treaty. Very much in the treaty, and very often forgotten that it is in the treaty. And obviously, as a lawyer, I have the bad habit to refer to the treaty and to say that much more is possible if we would make full use of the competences which the EU is having under the treaty. We have things like Horizon 2020, the framework programs. We have the EIT, not to forget the EIT, the ERC has been mentioned. We have the EU Charter for Researchers, the code which we just celebrated its 10-year anniversary, and things like that. So certainly, ERA has been developing. But it's clear that it is not enough. And that was also the point of Commissioner Geoghegan-Quinn when she in 2012 said, well, we are now building this European research area since the year 2000, but where are we? Have we done enough? Can we do more? And of course, I was very pleased that at a certain moment, Commissioner Geoghegan-Quinn said, well, I will give everybody who is involved in ERA a kind of final chance to get its act together and to make sure that this ERA is progressing at a much higher speed than it has been done by now. And by now, that meant a kind of voluntary, bottom-up approach. Mayor Geoghegan-Quinn said, if you don't get your act together, well, I would take the initiative for a kind of legal framework for the European research area and come up with an ERA directive. Obviously, we all knew that she was too far in her term for this to be a kind of realistic idea, that the directive still could be adopted. We still need about 2 years to make something like that possible. But it was clear that in 2012, things would have to speed up. And the priorities already have been indicated by the previous speakers: more effective national research systems, optimal transnational cooperation and competition, open labor markets for researchers, gender equality and gender mainstreaming in research, and optimal circulation, access to and transfer of scientific knowledge, including the digital era. And the 2012 communication on ERA was accompanied by another communication of 2012 on the enhancing and focusing of EU international cooperation in research and innovation. And since 2012, we have made progress. And if we look at the ERA progress reports, we know that progress has been made, but not enough. That it is too slow, that it is too diverse, depending on the topic, the country, depending on universities, funding organizations, and things like that. That's why the Council has asked the Member States to take ownership, finally, of the ERA process by developing this ERA roadmap 2015-2020, of which I have written last week, if you have seen the Yleru press release, that this is a disappointing document. That there is, at the end of the day, if you read the document, not one new idea on ERA in those 65 pages or something like that. And so the whole question is this sufficient? We had put as Leru our hope on the European semester cycle that this would improve and speed up things with regard to the ERA realization. Well, this is not the case. That's why we, in view of the new parliament and the new commission coming in last year, we drafted this document, an ERA of change, indicating to all the involved players that the five priorities plus internationalization are fine, but that we also need to focus, and I was glad that Professor Carvalho already indicated those as priorities this morning, that we have to focus on science 2.0, now open science, the nexus research, innovation and education, social science and humanities, research integrity, and as also was indicated, the link between science and society. Concluding, Mr. Chairman, we are not there yet. And we have to speed up, because the rest of the world is not waiting for us. We have to get our act together on ERA and all the ERA priorities. And I'm not going to come up with or push you with all kinds of suggestions, initiatives, which are of a legal nature. But I tell you now that if it is up to Leru, defending legal initiatives on ERA will be something that we will defend, continue to defend, if we see that progress on ERA is not speeding up. The Lisbon Strategy and all the following documents were documents which were fit for the time frame in which they were adopted. But they are not fitting anymore for the years which are ahead of us. And if we want to stay in the lead, as one of the other speakers also indicated with regard to everything that is digital, if we want to stay in the lead in Europe on this issue, we will have to speed up, we will have to work together, we will have to coordinate, so that at the end of the day, we can act on a global scale as a group of 28 member states. Thank you very much. Thank you.